Hello everybody, and welcome to the KSP video, attempting to fly a space plane on Laythe. So here you can see we have five orange tanks at the bottom, with four skipper, one mainsail in the middle, six boosters on each tank. Then the upper stage is a skipper engine with a orange booster, and on the sides are nuclear motors attached to fuel tanks on docking ports, so they can be attached to the space plane after it makes it into orbit. And plenty of monopropellant. So now we are going to launch this into space, and this is actually being post-recorded, so as you can see, one of my boosters just fell off, and I didn't realize that. So I was playing around trying to get the sun to come up so the video's nicer, and I hit spacebar, and everything goes to hell, and I'm like, oh my god, what is going on? Why is this happening? I'm trying to make a video, and then this ship, which has worked 10 times before, is all of a sudden just going blah. So I'm like, well, I guess we'll follow it to the ground. Boom. So game lagged. I've been having lagging issues when screen recording because I'm recording at 50 megabit quality, so we have nice good quality. I'll probably turn that down because Kerbal was not behaving. So now we are 4x speed again, and we are going to try to relaunch this. I didn't change anything because I knew it was just a glitch. So I'm looking around, and I see another booster drop. This time, I think, did I see it this time? Oh, okay, now I see it. All right, and I'm like, well, crap. So try again, revert to launch. So look around. Okay, they're all attached, no glitches. So we'll time warp, and they're still attached, so now we can go. And we are having a successful liftoff. We have autopilot engaged at 150,000 meters above the surface of Kerbal. We are depositing a probe-controlled fuel station, refueling station, with two extra motors, or engines, rocket engine, rocket motor. I don't want to get into that debate right now, but yeah. So we separate our stages, which are helped along by separatrons, so they fall away properly. And now we have our four skipper engines and one mainsail engine propelling us. The mainsail's for thrust, and the skipper engines are for control, because the skippers have thrust vectoring and the mainsail does not. So we are now entering our gravity turn and trying to save as much fuel as possible. The autopilot is very good at that. We have more than enough delta V. However, we want to save some of that to transfer into the space plane once it makes it and rendezvous with the station. And also the monopropellant. We have RCS on, so it can get into a much neater orbit. RCS definitely helps the autopilot maneuver. And it really doesn't use that much, but sometimes it has to. So now we are ejecting our liftoff stage, and I forgot to shut down the nuclear engines. I had them on a separate stage, but the autopilot auto-staged up to the top stage, which was not supposed to happen. So next time I will make sure to disengage auto-staging on the autopilot, because that wasted fuel that I really didn't want to waste, and it also caused some issues. But luckily the autopilot was able to crack for it, although it had to burn more fuel than I really wanted to. And this is actually, this is the Poodle engine, the most efficient large engine. So it's getting its target node and it's circularizing. So I mean, you don't have to use MechJeb to do any of this, you really don't. But I just do it because, you know, it's my choice. If you don't want to use it, fine, but don't bitch because I use it. Fucking hate it when people do that. But anyway, so we are now, what are we doing? We're in orbit. So yeah, we're gonna go back to the space center, and we are going to go pick up space plane version 7, or actually light space plane version 7. I had a much larger version, and it was just too heavy and required too much wing span and too many engines, and it just got massive. So I'm checking my center of gravity, making sure everything's right, and you'll notice right away my center of gravity is not over the docking port, although it is within the engine. So I have two Rapier engines, which convert from jet engines to rocket engines, and then I have one turbojet engine on the back, because the turbojet is so highly efficient. And I have solar panels, and I was checking to see if the generator was lighter, and it was actually substantially heavier, so I kept the solar panels. Whoa, my screensaver just tried to come on. But anyway, so what we do is we engage our space plane guidance at 100,000 meters, or 50,000, no, I did this time I did it at 200,000, I don't know. I engage the space plane guidance at much too high of an altitude, which will lead to fuel losses, and you'll see what happens because of that later. But basically, we have to get as fast as we can go off the runway, and the autopilot's trying to lift the plane off the ground, but for some reason it just won't nose up, which is a good thing, honestly, to me, because I wanted to stay on the runway until it's at max speed. So we're about to hit the edge of the runway at 120 meters per second, which is insanely fast. And we are now letting the autopilot take over. And as you can see on the nav ball, our pointing vector and our velocity vector are very close, and that's exactly what you want. That means you're very, very efficiently burning fuel. And if it isn't like that, you need more wingspan to get more lift to bring your position vector and your velocity vector closer to equal. So we are now going to 4x time warp through this entire long process. And contrary to popular belief, this barely uses any fuel. Like, if you watch the fuel meter in the top right, I'm really barely using fuel. And I have a liquid fuel only compartment up front by the nose, so I don't waste the fuel that's meant for the rockets. And what happens is at altitude, this will automatically convert over to rocket fuel when it loses air intake, which is one of the reasons why I have so many air intakes on it, so it doesn't run out of air. Now, what I do here is not only did I set the space plane guidance at too high of an altitude, but I went and I panicked and I disengaged the turbojet too quickly when I should have let it, it's not called burning out, when I should have let it, I had the word in my head a couple seconds ago. I should have let it lose all its air before I disengaged it, because otherwise it would just leak fuel if you left it engaged. And so what happened is those two remaining jet motors were having trouble keeping the plane aloft, and you can now see our position vector and our velocity vector are changing from each other. And so also I disengaged the space plane guidance and engaged the ascent guidance for rockets, which is what I should have done, but only after they switched over to the rocket motor. So I really screwed this up here. And so you can see I'm wasting 45% of my fuel, about maybe even 50%, because my position vector and velocity vector are not equal. So now you can see it turns pink. I guess that's just to show that it switched and now it's on rocket motor. So now you can see we are burning a lot of fuel, and we already are in serious trouble here. We're only at 30,000 meters. We should have been way higher than that on regular air intake, liquid fuel, jet engines. So we're in trouble. I was not happy that I have had two failed launches in a row, first my station and now the space plane, and all of this was tested and working perfectly before I even bothered to start this video. And so I was just like, ah, damn it. But this is an uncut video, it's just sped up in places, so there is no trickery, nothing like that. So it is now trying to circularize, and there is not enough fuel to circularize, so we're just going to let it decay into the atmosphere and burn up and launch a new one really quickly, because, you know, why not? So, yeah. So I try to engage the rendezvous autopilot, and I realize I am out of fuel, and I'm like, fuck. So we go to the Space Center, and now this entire launch, this entire second space plane launch, you can see I'm checking everything, everything's all right, so we're launching. It's all going to be in 4X. We're all going to have super accelerated space plane stuff, because I don't want to waste your time. You don't want to waste your time. So we are going 10,000 miles an hour off the runway. No, but we're going fast. So 120 meters a second, okay, everything's good. Velocity and position vectors are fairly equal. And so we are going to continue this, and this time I'm going to do it the correct way and wait until it flame out. It's a flame out, that's what it's called. And wait until the turbojet has a flame out because it doesn't have enough air. And when that happens, then we will disengage the turbojet. The rocket, the Rapier engines will automatically switch over, and then we'll disengage space plane guidance at the same time we engage ascent guidance. I actually engage ascent guidance first, and then really quickly disable space plane guidance before it trips balls. If I did it the other way around, I think the results would be a lot worse. But anyway, so this whole thing is going to be accelerated. It'll be over soon. looks like about 30 more seconds, maybe a little more, maybe a minute. But anyway, story time. I met this girl online. The last girl I was dating didn't work out. Go figure. But this girl is really sweet, and we were supposed to have a date today. But last night she was working, and she works where she has to basically talk all day, and she lost her voice. So she was in town today, so she stopped by for a couple minutes because I had gotten her some flowers, and I was like, hey, I kind of got you a surprise. Can you come over? Because I didn't know if the flowers would last the night. Like, some flowers last weeks and some flowers last hours. So she came over, and she was all surprised that I got her flowers, and then we watched an episode of The Walking Dead, and then she had to go because she wanted to rest and try to get her voice back for work tomorrow. But I was just like, oh my god, I spent all night last night, hours and hours and hours cleaning the house and cleaning my bathroom and organizing stuff, and because she's kind of meticulous. At least that's what her roommate says. Her roommate says she's very meticulous about keeping things clean, which is awesome because I'm totally halfway OCD about shit like that too. So now, as you can see, we are circularizing our burn properly, even though the control has issues with that. So now we are going to engage our rendezvous autopilot, with the target being set as the station. And since the orbit is barely higher, it's called a phasing orbit. It takes a couple rotations around the planet. But now we are slowing ourselves down, and it is doing what it calls matching velocity. So we already did the home and transfer because we were already in a phasing orbit. So now we are matching velocities. We are coming as close as to the station as we dare at that speed, and now it will do another intercepting burn, so just a couple meters a second to kind of propel it over there. And as you can see, we are getting closer and closer and closer, and I do have RCS on because I know I'm going to get more fuel, and it helps the thing turn faster and stay more stable. And you'll see later that RCS became very, very important for this attempt to fly a space plane on Laythe. And this video is part one. It should be on the title, but if not, it's part one. There's another part coming up once I finish being bored of Kerbal, because I burned myself out on this game, you know, the 7, 8, 9, 10 revisions of this space plane trying to get it to work right. Actually, like, there's 20 revisions. Okay, so we open our docking port, and we control from here, and then I think I did some manual maneuvers. No, because I'm far enough away, I don't think I did. So then we right-click on the docking port on the station, and click set as target, and then we enable autopilot with a speed limit of 1 meter per second. And now we're going to watch this in 4x, because it takes a long time, but it's still cool to watch, especially in 4x, because you can kind of more see what it's doing. And I'm actually helping the plane rotate on its axis, because the docking autopilot doesn't care about the rotation axis, only the yaw and pitch. No, I was manipulating the yaw. It only cares about the pitch and roll. The yaw doesn't matter on a docking port. So now you can see we are coming in close, and bam, we are docked. So now we are going to quickly, and this is still on 4x because it took forever, transfer all the fuel we can from our giant massive refueling station to the plane. And you have to individually transfer to each tank, which sucks. And also the sun goes down, so now we lose all of our fancy... I got mail. We lose... I don't know if you guys heard that. We lose all of our fancy, fun, light to light everything up nice and bright. And we transfer monopropellant. Obviously, we need monopropellant, and I'm so glad I transferred monopropellant because we end up needing all of it because I fucked up on the space plane design, and you will see why in a minute. So, still transferring fuel and trying to divide my attention between this girl I'm dating and in the video. Girls are more important than video games. Anybody that disagrees is a faggot. She asked me what I'm doing. I am recording a video. Telling her to be careful tomorrow because the weather is just bad. So now we are undocking the fuel tank, and we are undocking the space plane, and then we are taking the station, and basically, I couldn't find the keys on the keyboard for the thrusters to go forward and backward, so I just ended up having to kind of rotate the station slowly out of the way. And I really wish I would have just been able to hit backwards, reverse, and just have it fly away. So I just kind of you know, just mashed the keys until I could get it out of the way and out of danger. So that took a little longer than I had wanted it to. And I'm playing this in real time because I want you guys to see the effort that goes into doing this stuff, you know. And I could have, now I'm going to switch over the space plane. I'm going to control from the docking node. Then I'm going to target that docking node. And I actually manually roll it over first because I know the docking autopilot would have a shit fit if we tried to do it like this. So you can see me trying to figure out what the roll button is since I'm controlling not from the cockpit, so all the buttons are switched around. So I'm rolling it over, and then now I'm engaging my autopilot, and it's really quickly going to move up and dock. And I'm doing this in real time again so you guys can see how slow of a process this is. And even if you did have it set on 2 or 5 meters a second, it would still calculate how long it takes to slow down as it comes into the port. So it really wouldn't be that much faster, but it would be extremely more dangerous. I would recommend 2 meters a second if you're really, really freaking anxious and you know you're not going to crash into anything and your ship's all robust and super sturdy. But I think 1 meter a second even is too fast sometimes, because I think here it almost bounces off. No. That was earlier when I was fast forwarding. So we're making sure we have full fuel. Now, MechJeb completely freaks out at this point, so MechJeb's become absolutely useless for Delta V. So we shut down our Rapier engines, and then we activate our nuclear motor. What am I doing? I'm controlling from the docking port, so the nuclear motor is its axis of control. Checking the fuel again for some reason. Okay, and then we are going to activate the nuclear engine. And MechJeb still has no fucking clue what's going on, but I know for a fact the nuclear engine can go very, very far on this much fuel, because all the fuel inside the ship, and then all that new fuel in that little tank down there. Now, if you watch closely, you're going to see exactly why I ran out of motopropellant, and this video is going to have two parts. So I think we're getting close to the end of the video. I'm not entirely sure. So I'm doing everything. I'm targeting. I'm spinning around a little bit so I can thrust into orbit around the sun without wasting fuel by accidentally going backwards, because I'm trying to accelerate my orbit around the sun to get to Jool, which in turn gets to Laythe. So as you can see, I turn on the motor, and it pushes the whole ship sideways, because when we added the extra weight and when I was constructing it, I did not put the docking port in the center of mass. And of course, the center of mass changes when you burn fuel. So I turn RCS on, and RCS actually keeps it stable. But the problem is I only have like 200-300 RCS fuel, which is nowhere near enough. And it's wasting fuel at about 10%, well, 10 degrees. So that's actually a little more than 10%. 11-12% of the fuel is being wasted and having to be counteracted by the RCS thrusters, wasting even more fuel. So we are very slowly, and I'm trying to use physics warp in the game, but my computer, like I said, was running slow because it was also video recording. It's super crazy 50 megabit HD, you know, commercial grade video, which I'm going to have to turn way down next time. So the hardest part about this is the nuclear motor takes forever. So the fact that I have to do this manually and I can't do it on autopilot's even worse. So we're literally, I mean, where this is at 4x speed, and this is how slow it's going. I mean, if you guys are surprised, I mean, you shouldn't be if you've used the nuclear motor before, because the most efficient means it's going to be slow. Well, actually, the most efficient is the ion drive, but that thing is worthless. Your ship would take days to thrust to anywhere, I mean, unless you have a little tiny probe ship. So, yeah, I mean, it's not fun. And this winter storm that's predicted for tomorrow, I don't know if I'm actually going to be able to get this video online. Probably won't even be online until tomorrow morning. But, yeah, the storm says at least 3 inches of sleet plus another 3 inches of snow on top of that. And I swear to God, if our university doesn't close school like it should in those kind of conditions, I'm going to be fucking pissed. I'm going to find a friend with the four-wheel drive, I'm going to take my production camera, and I'm going to go out there, and I'm going to interview every single person I can, and see how many people I can get that are also slipping and sliding or falling, pissed off, whatever I can do to make sure the school's policy is changed. Because right now, the policy is each individual professor is responsible for canceling his or her class during inclement weather, and only when there is severely endangering weather, like super crazy blizzard 10 feet of snow, will the chancellor actually cancel all of school? Because if a teacher cancels class, the school doesn't lose attendance points in the system. The teacher actually gets an absence, which is fucking bullshit. So they get an absence, an unpaid absence, or they have to use a paid vacation day or a paid absence to get off school in dangerous conditions when you shouldn't be in school in the first place. And it just makes me sick. And I want it changed, and I'm sure there's plenty of people and plenty of professors who want it too, but professors can't talk out against the chancellor because they'd get fired. You know, I mean, it's bullshit. And Student Affairs has not once ever responded to any of my emails. I have emailed them so many times. So now you can see I'm trying to use autopilot, and it's kind of causing the ship to twist and turn. So I use autopilot to get me the node. And now, for whatever reason, the ship is becoming more and more unstable because the fuel is sloshing around or whatever. So I can only use about one-third, two-thirds thrust. So now an already slow motor is even slower. So for the whole rest of this trip of trying to do this, like basically until I'm out of monopropellant, I'm thrusting and thrusting and thrusting this and just trying to, you know, in general, get this thing where it needs to go. And I realize far ahead of time that I have no chance. That I'm just gonna have to redo it. So, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I'm trying to pull a Scott Manley here and commentate afterwards. I didn't actually record any audio at all while I was doing this because I was watching TV and talking to friends and all kinds of multitasking shit. But again, I mean, if you guys go to my YouTube, go to my YouTube channel, and I don't remember if I actually put the video in any of my playlists. I don't think I did. If you just go to my overall videos tab and just search Missouri S&T or search weather, and the video will come right up. You literally can watch my car slide 2 or 3 feet down the school parking lot, which is supposed to be plowed, by the way, and it wasn't, and it was covered with an inch of ice and 2 or 3 inches of snow. But then you see me trying to drive down Main Street, which also isn't plowed yet, even though it's several hours after it stopped snowing, and I am literally sliding sideways almost into the sidewalk where a bunch of kids are standing, and I'm going like half the speed limit. I mean, I'm going slow as I can without, yeah, so you guys see now that everything is going crazy, everything's twisting around, all the fuel balance and levels are off, and I basically just, all in all, just fucked up really bad. So next time, and you'll see I actually edit the jet in this video, I show you exactly how I'm going to make sure it works the very first time next try, which will be the next video. It will be a much shorter video, and all it will show is launching the space. I'm going to launch the fuel station ahead of time and connect it with the old fuel station, because I don't know how much is left. And then I'm going to launch this on video. I'll launch the space plane, time warp, connect to the fuel station, all this in time warp. And I'll do everything in 4x speed until I actually get to Jool, where then I'll go back to normal speed and show you how I circularize, how I get down into Laythe's atmosphere, flying around, doing loop-de-loops and all fun shit, and then hopefully landing on the surface and planting a flag and not blowing up into pieces. So as you can see, I'm transferring all the fuel out of the fuel tank that is on the nuclear engine, and then I'm disengaging the nuclear engine, and I think we're back in real time here. I'm trying to watch this as I commentate, and my computer, like I said, has just been kind of janky lately. I might have to run a virus scan, or I might have to dump some of my porn off the hard drive, do some defragmenting. But so now I'm re-engaging autopilot. I made the cockpit, the control node, control from here on the cockpit, and so I'm letting autopilot do its job. But the problem is these Rapier engines are substantially inefficient. I think they only have an ISP and a vacuum of like 350, 360, which is how all the other rocket motors are, except the nuclear engine, which is like 900, three times more efficient, or even more than that, I think. The turbojet's actually 1200 ISP, but that's with air, and there is no air in space. An ISP is specific, I don't know, I think it's the velocity of the exhaust at the mouth of the rocket or something. I remember Scott Manley spending like 10 minutes explaining it. Like, he's like my inspiration for playing Kerbal, honestly. That's where I got the flagpole Easter egg from, is him. He just accidentally discovered it in his newest video, and I've never even seen or heard of that before. So, oh yeah, so I forgot to engage my Rapier engines. So now the autopilot's really tripping balls. So I have to disengage, re-engage the autopilot. We're out of monopropellant, so now the reaction wheels in the jet cockpit are taking forever to get everything oriented. So I'm just kind of playing around trying to give you guys cool views to look at. We can still see our little nuclear engine just floating there. Very, very slowly floating away. So we are now going to hop back up to 4X as we watch our nuclear engine fly away into the distance. And 4X. So let's see, do I have any more stories while we're wasting the rest of our fuel? So if you look in the top right, you can see the fuel is going down insanely fast, and we still have extra liquid fuel. So that worked fine, that makes sense. But even MechJeb up in the top left there is not giving me the correct Delta V stats, because I'm staring at that when I was recording this, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to make it, awesome. And then I look over at the right, and we're out of fuel. And I'm like, fuck, not even close. He'll be stuck in orbit for the rest of his life. We don't rescue Kerbals. You know, we're Russians. We just leave them up there. I mean, you know, send some vodka, make their lives a little easier as they slowly wither away. Plenty of oxygen. They're just going to die of starvation. Or they're going to drown because the toilet overflows and then floats around, and let's not talk about that. That actually made me a little sick just saying that. Excuse me. Oh yeah, okay. Okay, anyway, so we're taking the jet plane off, we're adding a docking node, and I know docking nodes are flexible, so don't yell at the screen just yet. We're adding another one, and then we're adding that. So now, ta-da, we can undock the nuclear motor from the station and then dock it where the turbojet used to be. Which, oh wait, I didn't even think that I'm going to need that when I get to Laythe. Well, I do have turbojets in the Rapier engines, but they're just not as efficient. I might have to rethink that. I think I'm going to keep it like that. So then we are using strut connectors to solidify the connection, because the docking ports are so fucking stupid flexible, and I really wish they'd fix it or make a rigid docking port or like a square docking port or something. Ugh, it just makes me mad that the docking ports aren't rigid. They're like freaking flexible fucking rubber hoses. That's how bad it is. Makes me angry. Anyway, so now we are going to just do, in case you didn't see the flagpole Easter egg, I just decided to throw this in because it was all in the same video file, and it's only like a couple 20 seconds. So we are going to test this thing. We're going to make sure the engine is solid, and it is. You can see it's not flopping around like normal. So now I am trying to turn the ship. Obviously, it's not meant to turn on the ground since it has four wheels, two of which are two of which are in line. So we're jumping out, we're planting a flag, and then we are sprinting. You actually hold down the shift key and they'll sprint, and we're at 4x speed, and so we're just flying across the landscape and to the flagpole, which is where Scott Manley, while he was doing a memorial service, which was hilarious that he was doing a memorial service, and you can actually climb the flag, but because he showed us a secret, he has to pay for it with his life. Poor little guy. And he's dead. He died with his eyes open. See, he's dead. And good night, everybody, and bye.
Power Sports 420. Dirt bikes, automotives, and video games.